Technology and innovation is what Formula One is all about.
Formula One is probably the largest team engineering competition in the world.
We are much more focused on data now than we were in the past.
Technology, full stop, in our world is the bedrock of everything that we do.
Racing, technology and innovation have always been key to a successful season, and the engineers are some of the best in the business. Their job? To build a car that pushes the limit, a perfect combination of speed and performance.
I think Formula One is all about performance, and it's performance which drives success on the racetrack. So we as engineers are always focused on how can we get the quickest car, and to achieve that requires a very innovative approach. The main ingredients are the chassis, the power unit, the driver, and the understanding of the tyres. And without all four of them operating at a very high level, it's very difficult to have real success.
Getting that combination just right is what every engineer in F1 strives for. But just how much time does it take to design the perfect car?
There's different approaches to designing a Formula One car. Either you take the base of what was your previous year's car and you carry that over, or you're going for a completely conceptual change to unlock more performance. In both cases, there's still a lot of work that goes into physically building the car in the winter season.
About 30% of my time is spent on technology. What are we going to do that makes a difference up and down the pit lane? How are we going to differentiate ourselves relative to 9 other teams that are wanting to be successful as well? Where do we invest that technology? Not just financially, but time as well. How do we carve out enough time within an organization that we're not just doing the same thing over and over, but we automate and improve that in the future?
As one of the newest team principals to arrive on the grid, Vals has high hopes for the next few years.
What I'm doing is creating technologies and infrastructure that allow us not to produce a good car in 24, but allow us to produce a good car in 2026, 27, 28. And it sounds so far away. In our world, we normally think about one race in the future, not 3 years in the future. But it's really important to set that right timeline out. What we're fixing can't be fixed overnight. And you can, but you'll shortcut it and regret it because you'll fall over again in the future.
The design and build of an F1 car is a labor of love and a bespoke process for each of the 10 teams.
Formula One is quite unique. You get to trial something, you get to see if it works at the racetrack. If it doesn't, you go away, you redesign, you re-engineer it, you take it back to the racetrack 2 weeks later. And this time you have to hope it works. And if that is the case, it's how we improve the performance of the car, whether that's race by race or year on year. And I think that environment is what really breeds the innovation that we see.
While it's exciting to finally see the car on the circuit, most of the work happens well before race day.
I guess if you're a fan, then what you see is what you get on the television. We iterate a lot at the top end of our concept, which in aerodynamics, and we use something called CFD, and that in effect is a digital wind tunnel. And what that allows us to do is to iterate different concepts without actually physically having to build the car. Once we think we've found a design that is performant, we then build a 60% version of that, and we put it in a wind tunnel. And that gives us the first indication of how is this thing actually going to physically perform on track. As it goes through that process, we'll then do a number of simulations against the tracks that are upcoming for each of the races. And we'll also give that setup to our drivers in the loop simulator. So the drivers can get an early digital feel of what the car and the setup may feel like when it gets to the track. And then of course it goes through our manufacturing process. We build the car and then we deploy it to an event.
In 2009, F1 banned private road testing outside of race weekends, so teams have learned to rely heavily on data and simulators to do most of the work.
You know, there's a lot of things that you analyze or work on before you even get to the racetrack, including, of course, spending time on the simulator as well, to really try and optimize the car as soon as it hits the ground.
The difference is this: a car now, when you build it and bring it together, so 20,000 different components, You can build it in a week and it all fits together perfectly because it's been designed everything in a digital world. 20 years ago, you'd build it and a wishbone would be going through a piece of bodywork, so you'd drill that out, then you find an axle's in the wrong place. Digital systems are the only way of doing something as complex as building a Formula One car and then developing the Formula One car race on race.
In 2021, FIA put limits on how much a team can spend on their car throughout the season. These cost caps are designed to level the playing field for all 10 teams.
Cost cap has meant a significant step in terms of sustainability from the financial point of view. We want to make sure that the gaps between the top team and the small team can be reduced, and this is the only way to make sure that this is possible.
Teams will have to operate within $135 million every year, and that's tightly controlled. There are some exceptions to that. So that includes the driver salaries, it includes the top three senior management team members, it includes marketing staff, includes some of the travel and expenses. Actually, the number is significantly bigger, and they're all looking at changing their budget cap to incorporate more, but raise the actual cost of that.
I have the advantage to come from a small team and to be now at Ferrari, and I saw both sides of this, and on both sides the cost cap was positive. When you are in a small team, it's much easier, I think, today to find sponsorship because you can argue that you will fight with the same resources. And when you are a top team, you can be profitable or at least to be balanced, and it was not the case in the past.
The entire spread of the field right now is less than 3%, and that's the smallest it's ever been. And you have the team that's in 10th place who can get into the final round of qualifying. That's nothing that you have historically seen.
Now, we as Williams are not profitable. We are simply having to invest so much into the organization, it will take a long time before we are. But I can see light at the end of the tunnel, which wouldn't have been the case without a cost cap. But there's also some bad elements to the cost cap. The cost cap is split in two. There's an operational side, an OPEX side. There's a capital expenditure side, which is 36 million across 4 years, because we like to be complicated. And the downside of that is what it means is I don't have the facilities in Williams that we need today. We're spending as much money as we can to get ourselves up to the right level, but it's a little bit slowed by that.
What the latest set of regulations have done is forced us to be able to change how we look at innovation. It used to be that we could be very innovative in fields which are right at the frontier, and we could afford to take maybe quite a major risk in terms of, are we going to get a performance benefit from this? Now, with the advent of cost cap and the latest set of regulations, we have to be very mindful of the cost, and we also need to focus very much on efficiency.
To succeed in Formula One, it's all about teamwork, relying on everyone from the drivers and engineers to the suppliers and broader team to create the perfect car. Another piece of the puzzle is leaning on technology and partnerships to help get there.
We've recently announced an expansion with our partnership with Google, and we've been using their technology throughout the team, and that's definitely been giving us a competitive edge. We're using some of their off-the-shelf AI capabilities to really start to challenge some of our inefficiencies and our processes to go, how do we do this better for cheaper? And how do we do this ultimately with less people and deploy some of that knowledge and skill set elsewhere where it's perhaps more valued rather than on a manual task?
A good example of the work we do with Google and how they're supporting on our performances around pit stops. In 2023 at the Qatar Grand Prix, we achieved the world record at 1.8 seconds. And the way in which we do that is obviously a lot of hard work, a lot of practice, but we use technology to support the analysis of the pit stop. So the team film the pit stops on the Android devices. They then share that data securely to the Android tablets where the team can annotate in the areas where they think that we can optimize and get better. And you know, that then supports the continuous improvement efforts in that space.
And it's not just about improving performance in the pit. Some partnerships are designed to help improve the very lifeblood of an F1 car, the fuel.
So since more than 70 years, we worked together with Scuderia Ferrari to understand the need of their power unit, the appetite, and how to recreate bespoke formulations of fuels and lubricants to meet their expectations.
And to do that, Shell analysts are at every race.
We have our small container, and inside there is everything you need in a chemistry lab. At every race, we have at least two analysts, and their task is literally to analyze all the fluids. For example, one of the most important analyses we do on track is the engine oil analysis. We take samples before and after every session and every time the engine is turned on. And we check that the content of heavy metals stays the same. If we see a sudden spike, that means that somewhere in the engine there is some wear and is a very early sign that something is not working perfectly.
Another crucial component of a Formula One car is the braking system. And all 10 teams rely on Italian company Brembo to create bespoke systems.
We work very strict with the team and in relationship with them. And the design is not our own design, but it's a co-design coming from the idea of the engineers of the different teams that have to adapt our product to their cars. You can imagine that from 200 miles per hour, when you hit the brakes on a Formula One car, you can stop barely in, let's say, 3 and point something seconds.
It's quite impressive. Of course, if you hit the brakes really hard at high speed, the car stops at a enormous rate. But of course, over time, you also get used to it more and more. Like the first time I did it, it was quite, you know, crazy. I felt like, wow. Now I feel it's more normal.
They thunder away to a perfect start.
The first official Formula One race was held at Silverstone in the UK in 1950. Alfa Romeo's Giuseppe Farina won the title. At the time, his car had an estimated top speed of 180 miles per hour.
A 1-2-3 triumph for the cars from Italy.
Since then, a lot has changed. Today, F1 cars can reach 225 miles per hour. And the design, the engines, and all the components are virtually unrecognizable from those early days as new technology was introduced.
Historically, it was always the case that if you have a look that on the even 70 years ago, F1 was there also to bring new technology on the brakes, on the turbo, on everything that coming with the F1. I think it's somehow the DNA also of our sport to have in parallel the sport and the technology. This changed a little bit because that we don't have the same regulation. It means that we are much more focused on data now than we were in the past. And it's probably the future of the technology in F1.
So we have thousands of sensors on the car, which are taking over 1 million data points every second. And it's our job as engineers to be able to condense all of that data into usable metrics that allow us to make better decisions to be able to either improve the design of the car or the operation at the racetrack and ultimately make the car faster.
The data is so vast that it gives you information about everything that's going on in the car. So we use it from everything around fuel loads to the way the tyres are potentially performing to how the car is behaving mechanically as it goes round the track. And obviously that will differ depending on the track you go to, whether it's a fast or a low speed corner track, the car will always behave differently. So all that information gives us something to go and analyze and make a decision on.
And it's up to the hundreds of technical staff to make those split second decisions, both on the track and back at the company's headquarters.
Whenever the real car is running, there are 60 operational staff who are allowed to be at the racetrack. There are about 20 of those are engineers and 40 are sort of technicians who are maintaining the car in the garage. Then back at the factory, we'll have 40 engineers also monitoring the car real time. We have direct links of data so that data is being passed real time from the racetrack back to our mission control room, of which everyone will be looking at their computer, providing feedback, and then being able to discuss directly with the racetrack engineers what they're observing, what their recommendations are, and they can then be actioned real-time onto the race car.
Looking ahead, the FIA, Formula One's governing body, has put in place new regulations for the 2026 season, which focus on a number of key concepts, including safety, car design, and sustainability.
The reason why we are changing regulation is because we need to always stay at the edge or anticipating the change that are around the world, around the table. And the complexity from the governance point of view, but also to be ready for big step change needs time. and will allow all the teams to try to once again to be the best, to show who they are. That's the beauty of Formula One. That's the beauty of our mentality, where at the end of the day, we may have different opinions, but we need to be constructive and building for a better future.